Thank you very much. Well, at the end of last lecture, I lost the track of my own lecture. And there were a few minutes left, so therefore I proposed an exercise. Is there progress on this exercise? Four planes in all four. This was just to fill the time. Huh? So I tell you what was the track. We had this theorem that HS, the dimension of the complex dimension of HS was G, the genus of S. And we supposed that the genus were bigger or equal to 2. That's what we proved last time. And then remember this space HS, that was the space of forms of this type on S, differential forms of this type with complex values, but moreover closed. So alphas inside this space, and we ask the alpha equals 0. That was the definition of HS. And we proved that we have many. Then I wish to have a corollary. So, corollary, what follows from this? And it follows for free. So, every surface of, do not say Riemann surface, of genus bigger or equal to 2, has a meromorphic function. You see this as corollary? Such an alpha, we can write it locally in a very special form. Look, we choose for this J field a coordinate system, local coordinate, Z, and then locally we can write alpha like this. And now the dimension is bigger than 2. So we have at least 2 such guys. So what I can do is, this is a one form, and this is a one form, and this dz is the one form which comes from the coordinates. So now we do something we learned at primary school. So at primary school, we learned that if you see twice the same thing, you can cross out. So what is this? This is the ratio of a holomorphic function by another holomorphic function. That's a meromorphic function. And the fact that alpha and beta are linear independent means that they do not have zeros and poles at the same place. So we get for free meromorphic functions. So if this becomes bigger, this dimension, we get more meromorphic functions. And in the case where dimension genus is 1, we cannot do this. We must invent something else. I don't do this. It's the Weierstrass function. Gives a meromorphic function. And in the case of genus 0, we can make from any course on holomorphic functions as many as we wish. In case of, because on C union infinity, the Riemann sphere, if I wish to make meromorphic functions, I just take a polynomial. A polynomial is a meromorphic function with one pole at infinity. And if you wish to take more, I take ratios of polynomials. So I can make as many as I wish. And even I can prescribe freely where are the zeros and where are the poles. There's no constraint about this is called a meromorphic function. So forgot to say this last time, and then therefore this exercise. That was the only reason, in fact. So let's try to make in a different way meromorphic functions. Remember, if we take the continuous function on the letter X, and X could be any metric compact space, then this ring of functions determines the topology of the compact space X. I want to have the same for Riemann surfaces. So when we take K of S, which is the ring of meromorphic functions, yeah, here we have one meromorphic function. And perhaps the constant function 1 is also 1, and 0 is 1. So we start already to have several. And hopefully there were many, many, many. And so we have a whole ring of meromorphic functions. Meromorphic functions, you can divide one by the other. So in fact, it is more than a ring. It becomes a field. We have the field of meromorphic functions. So the chance that we out of this field can make find back the Riemann surface is not so bad. So this is rather poor. We have important meromorphic function, uninteresting, also important, but completely without interest. This one is of interest, but we have only one which is of interest. So that's not enough. So I wish a method to make as many meromorphic functions as possible. Many, many, many. So we have our surface, And I wish to make a meromorphic function. So I wish to do something which makes the story more difficult. I wish that at the point P, we have a pole. And at the point Q, we have another pole. And we prescribe even how are the poles. So in a local coordinate here, what I said, we wish to make meromorphic functions. That is too fast. We do not make meromorphic functions. We make more such alphas. Alpha was a holomorphic one, which was closed, a holomorphic. We learned that to be closed means the same as that this factor function is holomorphic. I wish to make many, many alphas. Make many alphas. And the alphas which we want to make, these are one forms. These are one forms. We are complex, we don't know what it is. One forms on the surface. Even more, this alpha which we want to make is a one form which comes from a function. But this function is a real function. And this function has poles at point P and point Q, but it's not a meromorphic function. So how can we make an interesting function? So what we do is we choose a local coordinate at P. So ZP is a map from something of some radius, a ball of some radius around P. Ball and some radius around P is with respect to this coordinate. The boundary of that ball, or all the points which run here, such that the coordinate Z at those points is that's the boundary of the ball. And we wish naturally that the coordinate is centered at P, so the value of the coordinate ZP at the point P is zero. And it is a coordinate which matches the complex structure G. I did not prove that every complex structure locally can be described by coordinates. So it's very pleasant to be here. So that means if something is pleasant, time runs fast. So I run out of time. So we do not prove this in the lecture, but in the notes this is proved. And then at point Q, we take another coordinate with the same properties around the point Q. So we have a coordinate here and a coordinate here. Then we have this J structure. And this J structure tells you, gives you the possibility of measuring angles. So if you have the Z structure, by definition, if you have U, then you have J of U, and then by definition, this angle is the right angle. But all vectors in between get also an angle. Because what you can do is, you can say what is the direction of angle theta. I do cosine theta times U, plus perhaps the other way around, I do not know. I think it is okay, but never sure. Sine theta of J of U. If I vary theta for theta equal zero, I did the right thing, I have U. For theta equal pi half, I have this person. And then I have all persons in between. So the Z structure tells you in which direction I can run away. And if you have this at every point, then you can behave like what happened to me when I go to Bangalore. I start making a random walk in Bangalore. You remember locally, I turn little left and then little right. You walk. And then there's a mathematical tool says, so if you make couple, if you at every point you choose at random in which direction you run away and you take a good density function on how long is the step, you get something called random walk. And this random walk does the following. So what we do, we stake the walk. This is P and Q. I need another point, capital P. So the random walk of capital P, what does this? So at time, this is a function which tells me where I am at time t. At time zero, I'm at the point P. And at time t, I'm at the end of my random walk. But there are many random walk paths. So you choose direction infinitely off, you do this. And on the circle of directions comes with a probability measure, mu. And then you can take the product of such copies. Then you have a probability measure on the product. And I take countably many proper products. Still, I have a probability measure on this. So all those random walks, all those possible paths come with a probability measure. So I can take the exponential value of this thing. So now I wish to say when the trip is over. So here we have this ball of radius one, of radius r. And here we have a ball of radius r. And what we do is, if you start at point P and you find, say, random by your random walk, this institute, ICTS, you get something to eat. That's what happens. But let's say you get one something. And if you reach here, then you go to a restaurant, and you get also to eat, and you must pay something, minus one. So at every point P, the expectation is, this gives you a number. Because what we do is, we take expectation with the stopping condition that the path should be in the union of the boundaries of the two balls. Ball around P of radius R, and a union ball around Q of radius R. So we let run the path. When we reach the boundary, we get this one thing, or we have to pay this one thing. And we look the probability and what happens. So when I start near our institute, the probability is high that we find the way back. When I start somewhere far, the probability is high that I don't find the way back. So, and then I said differently, I wish that the price depends on the radius. So it is 1 over r. It is 1 over r, and here it is minus 1 over r. So this defines a function. I say f of p is this. And this is a function with the nice property that when I, at the point p, and run already a little, what is the expectation at p? The expectation at p is the mean value of the expectations which I get when I are around p. So this means the function is harmonic. And the good definition of a harmonic function is the value at the center of a disk is equal to the mean value of the function on the boundary of the disk. That's much better than formula with derivation and so on. So this function is for free harmonic. So this gives us something. So when I take this dfb, then I have a harmonic one form. And then we do a trick. We do d, we say the alpha p. I should say this depends on the chosen radius. The chosen radius. This alpha p, what is this alpha p? That is, should be one form, is dfp minus I times dfp g composed with g. This is a holomorphic one form. And because it is harmonic, it is closed. So now we have a holomorphic one form in the complement of the ball of radius r, here in the complement of the ball of radius r, which is holomorphic one form. And you see, if I make r smaller, the p becomes bigger. So when I do this in the limit, I take now limit alpha p, alpha index. It's a bad notation. I did a big mistake here. This is the value at point p. But alpha, So we get the function. I should not use p. But this clearly depends on the two chosen points, little p and little q. So this is f, p, q, this function. And it depends on the chosen radii around the balls. And alpha is d of this guy. And now I say what is the final alpha. Alpha index p, q is the limit for r goes to zero of alpha p q r. This is a uniform limit, of harmonic functions, again a harmonic function, and this harmonic function produces poles exactly at the two points. And then with what I did, this is a real valued harmonic function with those poles, and this we complexify. So we complexify. In fact, I add to this d of f r v q composed with g, but here multiply with minus I. Then, and this is my final alpha p q. That is the guy which is of interest. That is now a holomorphic differential with poles at the points p and q. Something should be noticed. They have residues, but it is chosen in such a way that the residues are opposite, so it does not violate one of the main theorems. The sum of the residues of a holomorphic one form should be zero. You should not construct one where this is violated. So we have for free meromorphic forms, which are with distinct behavior at the two ends. They are nicely without any zeros in between p and q. They have poles at p and q. The residues, they are poles of order one. goes to infinity like 1 over r, they have poles of order 1, and the residues are opposite. So now we can make many meromorphic functions. So I have many meromorphic functions. What I do is alpha pq over alpha p prime q prime. I vary the points. I have many, many meromorphic functions. And with this game, I can, for instance, produce 3 meromorphic functions, f1, f2, and f3. I need 4, f4. I can produce 4 meromorphic functions by varying the points at different places. And if you have 4 meromorphic, you cannot see there. If you have 4 meromorphic functions, then you can see this as a map from a point on the surface to F4, I land in the projective play, the projective space over complex numbers of dimension 3. When I have 4 meromorphic functions, and the one which I choose, I vary as much as I can the points PQ. In fact, the 4 will separate the points and give me an embedding of the Riemann surface. This is a map. P is in the Riemann surface and goes to P3C. And this map is injective, it is differentiable, and even it has the property that the differential of this map is at no point zero. So it is an embedding. This is an embedding, a holomorphic embedding. Of the Riemann surface in projective space. And we did not so much. This idea of PQ and you do this random walk, this is called potential theory. This potential theory makes for you this harmonic function. Then this harmonic function, you can make the differential C linear by what we did, by minus I times the turned differential. And then, so we can make many alphas of this type. So what we did last time is the most painful way to make such a holomorphic differential, the most painful way. But at the same time, it proves that that space is of low dimension. What we did is, dimension is, that's what we proved. But there are many, many others. So we have this holomorphic embedding. So in the first lecture, there was one word that was upgrade. You remember this motorbike which could run backwards? Upgraded motorbike. So here we have a kind of upgrade. We have a Riemann surface, and suddenly it sits in projective space. And it sits in a holomorphic way in projective space. So it becomes a holomorphic submanifold of projective space. And there's a theorem. Theorem of Shaw says the following. Every holomorphic submanifold in PNC is an algebraic submanifold. I must here be every holomorphic compact. It's not a local property, it's a global property. So this says that this Riemann surface becomes an algebraic submanifold in P3C. And now if you look from the computer viewpoint, imagine you have already a computer and you must by keyboard type in which Riemann surface you're talking about. And you have this description by coordinate changes, so many coordinate changes, and so that's a long typing job. But this means it is given by polynomial equations, and even we can figure out which degree. Therefore, it has a few coefficients. So when I give you those coefficients, which I can type in, this tells us that describe the Riemann surface. You can package this in a data package, which is very small. So what I propose, that we first prove this, that the Schaus theorem, let's try to prove this. So this tells us also in a strange way that the field of meromorphic functions determines the Riemann surface. You take four functions of random out of your field, that gives you an embedding, and then you know the Riemann surface. But of course, take something at random, nobody knows how to do. You need never more than four. But for some, it does not work with three. I think for the Riemann sphere, it works with two, with Z and 1/Z. So for an elliptic curve, the minimal equation is y squared equal to x and so, and then the Weierstrass-P functions, what you need is P and P prime and the constant function one. So you need three. And then if you go up in genus, you need more. But the interesting thing is you need never more than four. So the fact is the field of meromorphic functions is generated by three meromorphic functions. The whole field is generated by three meromorphic functions. It's also in the notes. We have no time to do this. So the field of meromorphic functions has a lot of internal structure, and we could, if we wish to say, we do not like to see pictures. Some people don't like pictures. So they say, we have this field, key of S, and now we do only algebra, and we know everything about our Riemann surface. If we wish, we can do this option. So how to prove this Schaus theorem? So does somebody know a theorem which goes as follows? You have something holomorphic plus some bound, and at the end your thing is a polynomial. Somebody knows such a thing? Something holomorphic, perhaps a function, a bound concerning that function, and the conclusion is this function was a polynomial. What? No, holomorphic. I said something. I did not tell you where's the definition, but you know you forced me to tell the definition. The function on whole of C. If polynomial and having only poles at infinity, not essential poles. I do not name how you say not essential, but if the pole is very, very bad, then you have not a polynomial. But if the pole is of some order, which can be measured, if f of z is less than 1/z to the power k, it's constant, then the polynomial, the function, in fact, is in fact a polynomial. So that is this Liouville or Roucher? I do not know. the name of that theorem. A holomorphic function on C that has gross less than z to the power minus k, then it is a polynomial. You know this theorem, but So I wish that fz, an absolute value, is less than a constant times z to the power k. We have a function f from c to c, holomorphic, and this is true. Then the conclusion is f is a polynomial. And then we can say something about the degree. Degree is less equal k. And this theorem has a name. I forgot the name. It's not maximum theorem. Roche. I know how to write it. I forgot completely how you say it. So this is something goes in that direction. Because here we have a bound and conclusion polynomial. So what we know about this space is a compact manifold. So a submanifold cannot escape to infinity. So the idea of bound is already there. So we wish to prove this. So first we do a proof for curves, for real surfaces in P2C. Real surface, we know what it is real dimension 2, and this is already complicated enough. This is of dimension 4. So we make the proof for this situation first, and then we say how we manage to go to higher dimension. So we have our surface, S. S is the image of this map. So say let's call it sigma. So surface goes here, and the image is sigma subsurface in P3C. So I draw here, and then a surface, when I start drawing, it becomes a curve, one dimensional. So I have our it has no singularities. So, and to make clear picture, perhaps suppress this. So we have any something. And the blackboard is P2C. So, to make it clear, has somebody an idea how looks P2 over the reals? You see this movie's band? Everybody sees Möbius band. And the Möbius band has a boundary, huh? So we walk on the boundary with some speed such that in 1 hour we are back. Huh? And on this disk, we walk with some speed such that in 1 hour we are around. And then I start identifying. Huh? So I add to the Möbius band from some side a disk. That is P2C. Can somebody explain me why this does not embed in R3? Huh? What? Why does this not embed in R3? I do not hear. Oh, there's no problem. This embeds in P3R. And P3R is oriented, and this is non-oriented. So why here it works? So why perhaps here also? The orientation not reason enough. So if you wish, Jordan. If, yes, that's true. If it embeds, then it bounds. But I wish to rule out that it embeds before that we go in such a discussion. So what we can do is, we can walk on the middle of this Möbius band and take the normal. And then we walk around and the normal points in the other direction. So I make a new curve that is the end of the normals, and then inside here also, and then connect like this. So when I can embed, then I find two things. I find P2 of R inside R3, and I find a kind of circle inside R3. And moreover, the two things have the property that the intersection of both is just one point. On the Möbius band, you take the normal, then the normal points are the other way, you take that arc outside the Möbius band, and then you are opposite with respect to the Möbius band, you connect, and then you have a circle, which intersects in one point. And what you can do with this circle, you can take this circle and drag it to infinity. Go with the circle to infinity. You take it and you imagine that the circle is a rigid copper wire and you move it to infinity. Move it to infinity. If you're far enough, it does not intersect anymore this P2C. Because P2C, we do not know how to embed, but one thing we know, when we manage to embed it in R3, then it will be compact. So at some moment, it does not intersect. But if you have a surface and the curve intersecting the surface and you move the curve, then the simplification occurs always. So when I have the curve above, no intersection, and below, two-point intersection. The points of intersection disappear by two. So this one, this, and sometimes we create new ones, but when we create new ones, we create two new ones. So one becomes perhaps three, becomes perhaps five, then again three, and so on, and so on, and so on. It will never be zero. So therefore, it is impossible to put P2R in R3. P2C is four-dimensional, and it's very difficult to visualize. There is, if you know Braille, with the nine dots, and you say that 5 points is something. And if you have two Braille letters, both of 5 points, with their four in common, then you say that two simplices meet. If you do this with the Braille thing, then you get the triangulation of P2C. It's not something for those like we with eyes who can see pieces, but those who use Braille, which is not my case, they have a very clear opinion about P2C. So not always true that vision helps. The first proof was Shaw, then came a proof by Serre, then a proof by Mumford. And I find all those proofs, you need to know something. But for the proof which I give here, you only need to know this Roucher theorem, which is basic luggage if you study a little mathematics. So what we do is we choose a point which is not at our curve sigma, at our surface sigma. And then we choose a projective line, which we call X, which is just any line. And of course, such a projective line, that is C union infinity. So let's think here at this point, that is the infinity point of the line X. And this point, I can connect the first chosen point and the infinity point of the line X, and this is the line at infinity. Line at infinity. So now I draw lines like this. So this intersects this first line called X. You should think this is X axis. So think X axis. We know P2 is C2 and then something at infinity. So I wish to have and such a line here. We call it Y, but we remember where it intersects the X axis. This intersects at some point, which I give a name, and this point, I remember the coordinate. Along this X axis, we have a coordinate called X. So this line intersects at the point with coordinate X. So I have a whole pencil of those lines. When I vary X, I have other such lines. So I have many such lines. So when this is point A, that is the line Y hitting the X axis at point A. And if this is point B, then this is Y index X of B. So the Y lines are projective lines, and on those projective lines, I have two points. I have the intersection point with the X axis and the chosen point at infinity. Let's call this double infinity. Very far away. So, but on this projective line, I have only two points. And if I wish to work with polynomials, I like to work with numbers, and I must be capable of making numbers. So I need a third point. So this point here, I call it the zero point of the Y line. And this point, I call it the infinity point of the Y line. And to have numbers, I must tell you where is one. So what we do is we take another line, and we call this other line X dash. So on every Y line, we have now three points. And our curve sigma intersects intersects in some points. When I vary, the amount of points cannot change, because the complex orientations tell me that when I move, there is no possibility. If you wish constant intersection, you must have intersections with or negative intersection and positive intersection. They can cancel. But here the tangent planes all are holomorphic. By definition, the tangent plane of sigma was holomorphic, has an orientation, a preferred orientation, and the tangent plane of the Ys or holomorphic with preferred, though there's no cancellation. So I get that the number of those points eventually counted with multiplicities are always the same. So now I can make for you a polynomial. So I wish to make a polynomial. It is the polynomial index X, that is the polynomial which concerns the Y line which intersects the x-line at point with coordinate x. So this is a polynomial which has a coordinate y. The coordinate y we know already a little is 0 here, 1 here, and infinity there. I must write a formula for this polynomial. The intersection points, they all have y values. So I take the y value of intersection point star number I, I number them. Then I do the other way around. I do y minus the y value of the point star I and take product over all I. That is, we explained already the number of intersection points does not depend on the line. So here I have a polynomial in y. And this polynomial has coefficients. That is y to the power d. D is the degree and the number of intersection points. And then we have a coefficient c1 depending on x. C1 depending on x, y to the power d minus 1, and so on, plus c index y to the power 0, have such a polynomial. The variation of those coefficients, because the tangents are all c linear, that means the variation of the coefficients is holomorphic. So all those coefficients are holomorphic. They are defined along the whole line, but at infinity can perhaps something go wrong. But what happens? Near infinity, 1 and 0 approach at linear speed. So what I can do is, I can near infinity draw another coordinate line. Then I have here 1 prime. And the ratio of those two is just the opposite. So what I know is this coefficient goes to infinity with speed z. The coefficient c2c, which is symmetric functions in those values, which are products 2 by 2, goes to infinity with speed z to the power. So I have c index ix. Absolute value is less than a constant, which depends on I, times x to the power I. So that means all those holomorphic functions are polynomials. So this is a polynomial in 2 variables. And when I add the 3rd variable to write a homogeneous polynomial, then I have a polynomial equation for my curve. That is Shaw's theorem in P2. It's just Roucher, nothing more. So what we do in higher dimension, let's do it for P3, and only curves in P3. So this proof works so what we did is here, we have a surface is something of real dimension 2 and something of dimension 4. When we are on Pn, then we are of real dimension 2n. And when I have a submanifold of dimension 2n minus 2, the same argumentation works. Difficulty comes when I, for instance, have a surface of dimension 2 in P3. So we have our sigma curve. And the whole thing is P3C. And you wish to do something. So what we do first is we take a point, Q. Does not play the same role as the first point shows here. But what I can do is I can take something of 1 dimension higher. I draw all lines from Q through a point of our surface sigma. So now the dimension of this object becomes one higher. So it was a surface, one complex higher. So it becomes two-dimensional higher. All those lines are complex lines. So it becomes two-dimensional higher. So this is real dimension. So our dimension is 6. And when I take this cone off, then I have our dimension 4. So what I find is this cone, so the cone with vertex q over sigma, by previous argument, is the zero set of a polynomial. Is zero set, is the zero set of some polynomial, depending on q, of course, but it is a polynomial in the variables x, y, z. Do the same. But what I can do is, I can vary the point Q. What is set theoretically clear? The intersection of cone Q, cone on sigma, intersection over all Q in P3, Q not on sigma. This intersection is the surface sigma. For every point outside sigma, I can find a direction. I take a point which does not lie on that direction. So that means I have an infinity of polynomial equations. But we know some algebra by Noetherian property, an ideal defined by an infinity of polynomials, in fact defined by finitely many. And then if you think a little, we can find out how many. So the cone over sigma is one polynomial. Then how many intersections I need has to do with how many double tangents I have and this kind of things. So but I can get rid of all of them. So how many equations I need, in fact, I don't know. But there are finitely many. So that means sigma becomes zero set of finitely many polynomials is an algebraic subvariety of projective plane, of projective space. And if we now have bigger dimension, what I do, I choose a simplex. I choose many points. Each point raises the dimension by 2. Then I take a hyperplane here, spanned by, say, 3 points. And then I join every point of this plane of some dimension with sigma. Then the dimension raises. Then I find the polynomial. It depends on this linear subspace, in the case where the dimension, the missing dimension is 1, so 6, and this is 2, and you have a theorem for 2 dimensions less, I need 1 point. But let's treat the case 8, and we have a surface. Then when I take 2 Q points, Q1, Q2, then I have a line, and I join every point of this line to sigma. That raises the dimension to 6. So for every such line, I get a polynomial x, y, the number of variables I do not know, scope up to n, which is zero on this join. It's not the cone, but on this join. And intersection again of all those, when I vary the lines, gives me sigma. Then the same argument, Noetherity tells me, finitely many suffices. But in fact, for Riemann surface, it is enough to understand it in P3. And there it is not so wild. That is, so every Riemann surface becomes an algebraic curve. Every compact Riemann surface becomes an algebraic curve. And that is really an upgrade. Because that gives many, many new tools. On projective space, I have many meromorphic functions. And I can restrict them to my curve, so I have many meromorphic functions. So you can start using algebra, maybe notice. Also, I can use this theorem with our forms So show this. Perhaps. So it's clear this. So many. This last line that 1 and 0 goes together by linear speed, then values of something going to the money, which is called inflation, and goes to infinity also by linear speed. If the unit becomes small, some fixed value becomes big, and the gauge multiplied by the value is constant. That's what I use. This goes linear. So symmetric function of degree 1 goes to infinity by degree 1. Symmetric function, we have 2 by 2 products, infinity by degree 2, and so on. That's the only thing what is necessary to understand. So let's use those alphas in completely different aspect. We have our surface. We know we have many meromorphic functions. That's all those alpha pq. So what I can do is, this is in fact the one form. This alpha pq was the one form. So I can put d in front of this. This is a holomorphic one form. Vanishes all over, except near the poles. So I took as price convention, if this is the radius r, I took as convention, you get 1 over r. But we change this a little. I pay you 1 over 2 pi r. Then, when we compute this, this is exactly Dirac measure at the point P minus Dirac measure at the point Q. So you must be able to compute D of something which is not really smooth, but perhaps with distribution theory or Cauchy principal values or generalized functions. In some way, this works. By some limiting procedure, you find this at many places. So D of this is this. Then we were interested in solving this kind of equations. Brackets are important. This was Laplace G, huh? And we wish to solve Laplace J equal to mu. Ah, we did it here. This is a measure. This measure has a special property. If I take, let's call this mu. If I take mu of the constant function 1, this becomes 0. So, what I could put here is a volume form, omega, and the constraint on this volume form is that the integral of this volume form over omega, which is nothing else as C omega as a measure, and take the measure of the function 1, that this is 0. So I should not say volume form, it's a 2 form on the surface with total integral 0. So this 2 form, we do something which is in an institute which did mainly physics a year ago, and what I wish to do now is for sure allowed in this room. So I write such a thing as a combination of measures which are balanced, which have integral 0. So I take pair of points and take with perhaps coefficients and take an infinite sum of this. And when I take many such points, this converges to omega. It's called discretization. And for everybody here, we can solve. We did it here. So this is linear. We can solve. This becomes, in fact, the proof. And this is the potential theoretic proof of what Francois used this morning, that every two-form with total integral zero can be written as Laplacian of a function, and here also some freedom, the function was well-defined up to constant. So this follows from this construction. So many meromorphic functions. Of course, there should be done something, which perhaps I don't do, but you have the idea is a measure you approximated by many Dirac measures. Then you can solve. Perhaps you must do something, convergence of harmonic functions, and then subsequence and something like this. But this is, if you work a little, becomes a proof. So we have, from the fact that we have meromorphic functions, we can do a lot. And we have seen up to now two different ways of making meromorphic functions. So I run exactly in the same difficulty as last time. Don't know what to tell now. So if you wish, we can think about exercises. So we had this sum with R4. Huh? But now we take R4 with the G operator. Is it always possible to find two complex coordinates such that the J operator in those coordinates is nothing else as multiplying by I? So find coordinates Z1, Z2 going from R4 to C, such that if you have such coordinates, then we have something which we call differentiation in that direction. But this is not so clear, eh? Because a complex direction is not one direction, it's many directions. Eh? So I prefer to split this. Such a thing is we understand differentiation in that direction, partial derivative, and then the other one. Eh? And so on. Eh? X2. And we know what means in coordinates turned by I degree, by multiplied by I. So the turning operation is derivative in the real line direction is the same as derivative in the imaginary direction. Huh? And the same here. So, and this operation is an operation on tangent vectors. And this stands for a tangent vector. Huh? So this is an operation on tangent vector. Can you find such that the multiplication by I, what is explained here, such that the multiplier equals G? Question. So in dimension 2, you can do this. That's what we said. Every G operator can be made more visible by making complex coordinates. And there it is easier. You need only one Z, one coordinate. And there the claim is it is possible. But it is not proved in the lectures up to now. So answer is deeply new. In general, not possible. And how to measure why it is not possible? This goes when we have such a J operator. We can split differential forms in different types. So what I can do is, I can look at forms of type 1, 0. And I can take D of this. So if we have coordinates, so this lens, this becomes a two form. Two forms that splits in omega. So we are on complex dimension 2, in omega 2, 0, in omega 1, 1, and omega 0, 2. Direct sum. So if we have coordinates, this never happens. Such a thing. If we have coordinates, such a thing, we can write it as a function times dz1 plus another function times dg2. And when you put d in front of this, then this function, so d of a function is, I take the Dolbo notations, is d dash of f plus d double dash of f. This is the C-linear part. This is the anti-C-linear part. This can be written as A times dz. This can be written as B times dz bar. We have function of two variables, so it is A times dz1, B times dz1 plus another A dash, dash is bad, alpha, no, also bad, another A, underlined, dz1, dz2, and here B, underlined, dz2 bar. So how many bars I get? I get one bar. So I can never reach this guy. Somebody here, locally, is written as a coefficient function h dz1 bar times wedge dz2 bar. So to measure how possible or impossible it is to solve this problem, we take d and then project to that component. So we do the following. We have a map N, which goes from omega 1, 0 to omega 0, 2. And what it does is, if you have a form omega here, you make first d omega, and then from this d omega, you take the 0, 2 part. Big theorem of Newlander and Nirenberg tells the following. To the question here, the answer is yes. If and only if this map N is zero. And this N is the N of Neuhaus. And this expression is called Neuhaus tensor. And it is a beautiful example for the purpose of learning what is a tensor. So this is a tensor. If you wish to compute this, You cannot compute at the point. The vectors you need, you have all to extend them to vector fields, and then you can start computing. But then you must, tensor means the result does not depend on how you extended the vectors given point-wise at points to vector fields. And this is a good example. We do this. I think stop here. Thank you very much.